welcome to the Heretic Mansion, a Shin Megami Tensei podcast. I am John, and with me are my pals...
Keith.
And I'm Sin.
And before we get this episode started, I just wanted to thank you guys for all the feedback you gave us. And I know there was an audio problem in the last episode. That was one of the most common complaints we got. Actually, it was really the only complaint we got.
Yeah.
But anyway, just thank you guys for telling me about that. People on the subreddit were saying stuff like, well, that's the split audio is a pet peeve, and it's a pet peeve of mine, too. But when I was proof listening to it, I was using the speakers on my computer, so I didn't really notice, but I'll make sure to fix that for this episode.
Yeah, even moving on, any feedback you guys have, just go ahead and throw it our way. We're totally open to change, and totally open to make this a better podcast than the week before. This is all new territory for us, so we want to make it as good as we can.
Right, and some people were also complaining that they couldn't hear Sin, but now he's got a better microphone, so we should be able to hear him better.
Yeah, about the same mic that John has, because John sounds fucking beautiful, so I got one.
Of course, if you're listening to this, you probably already know whether or not the audio is better.
Yeah, for all we know, they're like, oh, he fucking sounds way worse. Or now I could hear his shitty voice even more clear. Thanks.
And if it is, please tell us. If it's worse, please tell us so that we can fix it.
Yeah, unless the fix is remove Sin. I know.
Alright, so this week's subject, we're basically talking about Kaneko, because Kaneko, as I think, in my opinion, Kaneko is the heart of SMT. Like, he designs all the demons, he designs the characters, and it looks just really badass. What about you guys? What do you think?
Yeah, he's really the main reason I got into the series and why I continued to play. Even his absence, like, I just wait for the next, like, Kaneko character art style thing, like SMT5, hopefully.
Yeah, I like looking at art of from RPGs, because they seem to be the most like beautiful, you know, and not the most lifelike, I guess. The most like it's RPGs tend to have like more freedom of art, if you know what I mean, because you have fantasy settings, you know, and Japanese RPGs more so, because it's not just limited to fantasy, but all these other stuff. Well, anyways, yeah, Kaneko's art's amazing. It's easily my favorite art in video games, especially the character designs. I love the way he designs them, even with the whole upper lip stuff. Like, everyone, some people hate that, but I fucking love it. I want to get posters of some of his art, because it's so fucking awesome.
I mean, yeah, me too. I think his art, one of the reasons I like it is because it's very creative, but it also looks realistic. Like, mm-hmm. Most RPGs follow that traditional, JRPGs, they follow that, like, traditional manga style. We all know about that, but Kaneko's artwork, it looks like that, but at the same time, it looks realistic. It's kind of like a blend between the two.
Yeah, it's more striking. Like, if you look at, like, a picture of Chiaki next to a picture of, I don't know, Chie, it's totally, like, it's just more striking and more provocative, I want to say.
Yeah, it even gives off like a vibe, like an emotion almost.
And I mean, the artwork of, like, at least the character artwork of Persona, it looks more realistic than most JRPGs, but not as much as Kaneko's. It looks unique compared to other JRPGs, but I still think Kaneko does that better.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, especially
like 20 years, 20, 30 years.
Yeah. And just reading his, like, these interviews, all these things, like, from the, everything from his art books and just random interviews about the games, hearing him talk about how he thinks about the character design, it's not just, oh, I wanted this guy to be pouting, so he's pouting. He kind of goes, okay, so in Nocturne, I wanted this guy to summon unconventionally. I didn't want to have too much technology. I wanted it to feel natural. And I wanted a shaman vibe. He was inspired by the Red Hot Chili Peppers, too, for some reason. Hmm. And he took all of that and he reinterpreted a shaman. And it looks cool and it reads well. Like, when you look at it, you know, you kind of get the shaman vibe from Demi-Fiend, I think. And I don't think anybody else could have done that. If you had told, like, the guy that does Final Fantasy to create Demi-Fiend, it would probably just look like Titus or something.
Yeah. I'm trying to look for that Red Hot Chili Peppers look. Is it just him in shorts, probably? Like, Fleet?
Anthony Kiedis in shorts? I don't know. Maybe. Let's see.
I could see that, though. I think Demi-Fiend looks amazing. It's fucking awesome. I hope the cosplay is him next year, by the way. But, yeah, I think it looks awesome. Like, the tattoos. I could totally see that shaman vibe.
Yeah, and it's cool because he has, like, a vision for almost every character he designs. Like, there's, like, a specific concept in mind. It's not just like, oh, I have to make a buff guy, so now this guy is here. Or this guy's supposed to be serious. He, like, reinterprets the character tropes in a way that's more refreshing, I think.
Right, and as much as I like his people, the real reason I like him is because of his demon designs. Like, all the demons have so much detail, and like he said, he takes inspiration from other stuff. He doesn't just be like, okay, this thing is a dragon, so I'm going to make it look like a dragon. He actually takes inspiration from other sources. And all the demons, well, okay, 90% of the demons in the SMT series are all designed by him, and I can probably count on my two hands the demon designs that I actually don't like.
Yeah, let's do that, actually. Can you name, like, just offhand some demon designs that are terrible to you?
Diana.
Not Demi-Kid's Diana, though.
No. What was Kaneko thinking when he designed that? He's like, I'm gonna make a goddess and I'm gonna cover her in tits.
Yeah, actually, I want to see if I can find what he has to say about Diana in one of these interviews.
I don't really mind Diana. I just kind of like trying to. It's like I don't really take her design too seriously, but I kind of see what they're trying to go for.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not super knowledgeable about mythology. Like, that was kind of my like high school me. I was into that, but I do remember she's like fertility and hunting and stuff.
Yeah,
she got the bow, so that's the hunting. I guess the covered in breasts is fertility.
I mean, it might be. I mean, because a lot of times you see tits and you think like, okay, yeah, I like tits, so that they're good, nice to look at. But when you see so many, it's like, this is fucking retarded. I think just that instant, like, oh, this is so stupid, like, just stays with it. I don't know. I got over it. I think she looks fine. Like, all the demons are, like, phallic or like, that one vagina demon. Like, I don't really give a shit. To me, just look all right.
Oh, I know which one you're talking about.
I don't know his name. I don't memorize.
The thing probably... that's, like, a monkey with a penis head clinging to a pole.
No.
He's talking about Ariok.
Oh, yeah.
I'll send you a picture of him.
Yeah, I know what he looks like.
You still need the picture, though?
I don't know if I need vagina demon in my Google history, but it's in there now.
But the thing about that demon is that I heard from a lot of people that Mara was the only reason Persona 4 got an M rating, but Ariok was in Devil Survivor, and that game still got a T rating.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I guess you could see, like, I don't know.
I mean, when I played the game for the first time when I was, like, 15 and I saw it, I just thought, okay, it's a demon with a mouth. But then I took the time to look up the artwork on the SMT Wiki because that's what I did during class because class is boring as shit. But I looked at his design closer and then I noticed that clitoris at the bottom and I'm like, wow, this thing's a vagina.
Clitoris.
Clitoris. I'm not an expert on biology.
Oh, I'm an expert in vaginas, so that's kind of why I know that.
Of course. Hmm.
There's actually a Giant Bomb article, top 10 genital demons in Shin Megami Tensei. And of course, Mara's there, Ariok, Mishiguchi.
Just searching semen. I'm sorry, not semen. Oh, God. Just searching a vagina demon got me a lot of fucking interesting hits.
Yeah,
A lot of cool artworks.
Yeah, and a lot of the... actually, on that article that Keith mentioned, I've read it, and it also gives, like, a brief introduction to Kazuma Kaneko and his artwork. Which says a lot about him.
Oh, wow, who's this? Sorry. But yeah, Kaneko, like, the only designs that I don't really like are, like some of the ones that are too simple, they're hard to even, like, what's the one? Like, Dikarabia. Like, it's, like, simple. Like,
what?
It's hard to like. I mean, really, it's just a little fucking star with an eye on it. I don't know.
It's like the ultimate Staryu. It's like, what if Staryu was more legit somehow?
I guess. This is the eyelashes.
Yeah, I mean, I get that. He actually, like, took that design from an old manuscript from, like, the source material, so it's like pretty literal, like interpretation of the character.
Oh yeah, this list is interesting because it has one of my favorite demon designs, Tiamat.
Yeah, that's actually like she's one of the like multi-breasted ones that are actually a good design though.
Yeah, I mean even Satan. I always forget Satan has tits, or at least the most common version of Satan.
Yeah,
I'm surprised Tulu isn't on this list because he has a dick on his design.
I don't remember.
Yeah, in the SNT2, like, demon encyclopedia, it's like this crazy, elaborate, huge demon, and then, like, all of a sudden a little dick coming out.
I mean, I actually like Tulu's design, but he hasn't made an appearance in any SMT game besides SMT2.
Yeah.
Yeah, looking at this list, yeah, Diana looks fine, like, the tits on the knee looks stupid.
But at least it's comfortable if she falls down.
Yeah?
There you go.
Trying to think how.
You have Albion on here. Albion is like one of my favorite demon designs. I think we were talking about before how I like Sudama and Kodama. Like, I just like the simplicity and even like that whole demon race. I like that race. Jiraiya. Super into them. Yeah, like. They're all awesome.
Fucking Mara. It's like Mara's been beaten to death, no pun intended. Forget that he exists.
And that's the first one. That's the one that everyone remembers.
Yeah.
I always forget Mishiguchi's name.
Yeah, me too. He's like pillar penis. Like, that's...
I remember in one of the Facebook groups, I remember I posted a picture of him, and I put in this topic... In this topic, demons that you resemble.
Yeah, well, you guys should see Mishiguchi's old design. It's basically like a snake, except his head is a penis head.
I'm gonna do just that. That's what I need. Penis demon in my feed.
He's the Japanese god of lovemaking.
I could see that.
And there's also Rahu, which is basically a head with a horn shaped like a dick.
A head with a head on it.
Yeah, I've seen a porno or something like that. Wow, what the fuck? This Mishiguchi's old design, like, if I didn't know that wasn't a penis, I mean, I guess I could see a penis just because it's shooting something. Take away the cum spraying, and I could see that as a cool demon, a cool snake.
Yeah.
Damn, his Imagine design's pretty cool.
I haven't seen it.
Yeah, on the MegaTen Wiki. Yeah, but going back to Kaneko, like, yeah, the only designs I really dislike are, you know, like, the ones that don't really have, like something cool, like, just, like, the background demons, you know what I mean?
Like, yeah, like the filler demons.
Yeah.
We need 30 more demons, like, hurry.
Some of the ones that are, like, really out there, like, they're a mash of a ton of designs, like Master Therion, and what's the other one? Is it Hikati? I'm not sure how to pronounce that. Like, that's pretty out there.
Yeah, I don't know how to pronounce it.
Like, Pazuzu looks badass, but it's like... He seems like he could be more hardcore looking, Pazuzu, you know?
Okay.
Yeah, I always thought it was Hikati, because some songs... I listen to a lot of black and death metal, and like when they ever say that name, it's three syllables, Hikati. So I'm not sure if that's like the original way you say it, you know what I mean? Or that's just the way they say it for the song.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. But yeah, that demon, yeah, she's kind of weak. Design.
Yeah, like I said, like just the filler demons are pretty, like, you know, like all the cool fairy ones are badass, except Hypixie. Hypixie is too simple. But
actually, I just read his like description of Hypixie.
Hecate.
But it's weird though, because like, how do you feel about the Matama ones, like the four different elements?
I don't know what to say about them. I know they have like their place in the game in terms of gameplay, where you could like fuse certain. I'm sure you guys could probably explain. You guys could probably explain how they work in the games better than I do. Someone tried to tell me once, and then I just lost interest. Where like you make one and you fuse skills onto it, and then you fuse those skills back or something about stats. I don't know.
It's like you fuse it with a demon, and you'll get the same demon, but it'll inherit its skills. So it's basically like a chance to fuse the demon again if it didn't get the skills you wanted.
Okay, yeah, that's kind of why I figured. I just never really tried. I never saw the need. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Half the time, if I want to do something like that, I'll just register the demon, fuse it out, and then call it again, like pay for that demon again, and just go from there. Like, I don't think I've ever had a problem with money in any MegaTen game.
I had a problem with Strange Journey money, but I think it's because I was just fusing demons just to fuse demons.
Oh, yeah.
Like, just having fun, I guess.
In general, yeah, I don't like having fun. In general, in most RPGs I've played, like I almost never have a problem with money, because I just don't like spending it.
Even oh, you're one of those.
Yeah, like you gotta hoard it. Even in SMT1, like I had like 40,000 maka, and I was like, or whatever the fuck it's called. I think it's maka where the part I'm at, because the first part's not. It's probably. Yeah. But anyways, like I wasn't doing that much damage, so I was like, eh, should I spend 20 grand on a sword? Yeah, I'll probably find a sword in a boss fight or something. And I did, you know, but it took a long while doing like 10 damage per sword hit, where I was like, yeah, I probably should have spent the money and not save it.
I mean, I've had a problem in a lot of SMT games, but that's mainly because I'm basically a perfectionist when it comes to fusing demons. Like, I won't take anything less than the moveset that I want, so I'm constantly messing with the compendium, messing with the fusions, trying to get this demon with the moveset that I want it. And fuck. I usually end up spending all my maka on like one demon.
Fuck. Yeah, when I try to fuse demons, I try to stick to, like, instead of like trying to fuse and then seeing the moves they're gonna get and then backing out and then keep trying again and again and again, I just decide on like one move I really want. Like, all right, I really want Rakukaja, and go from there. Or two moves. Like, oh, I really want Rakukaja and Dekaja or something. But if it's like four moves and there's only four slots and I'm gonna be there all day switching back and forth, I just don't do that. I'm like, eh, I didn't buy this game to fucking do this. I want to actually fight. So let's just get two skills and we're good.
But I mean, it's not so much the just trying the fusion over and over again. It's getting the demon with the skill that I want. Like, I need one demon to have this skill and I need the other one to have this one. Like, I'm playing Persona 3 and I want a cert with Fire Boost and Fire Amp. If I have a Persona with just Fire Boost, I need to give the other one Fire Amp so he can deal even more damage.
Okay. Yeah, I can see that working.
How much, like, you guys have got a pretty good, like, idea of, like, Kazuma Kaneko's history of involvement in Atlas and how he came to be an artist and all that?
He's one of the first, seven guys that made Atlas. Is he not one of them? I know he's one of the main guys time behind the first SMT or the first MegaTen.
No, he actually came out in the second MegaTen.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was just gonna agree with you, but go ahead. But,
yeah, basically he played the first MegaTen. And then he liked it. And this was about the same time he was looking for a job as an artist for a video game company. And Atlas was the most accepting, so that's basically how he became the artist for SMT.
They were the most accepting. That's funny.
I mean, that's what Sojima did, too. He was like, oh, I went to Atlas because you were the first ones that to like call me back.
Well, they were just a startup, right? Like they were, you know, I could see why.
Yeah, but not when Tsujima was there or like coming in, because he came in around Devil Summoner era, where they're pretty popular now. And yeah, he just came in quickly. They called him back right away. Like, but he did say that Atlas was among his first choices, though.
And good for us, because we got one of the best artists out there, if not the best.
Yeah, exactly. It's crazy, like, reading these articles about Kaneko. He talks about how he basically started drawing because he thought that girls would like him if he drew. And that he only really listens to rock and electronica while he's working.
Is that true, Keith? Do the girls go after the artist since you're
an
artist? Oh, it's
no.
Not.
No, it's not. It's punk. But then, like, you know, like Keith versus Kaneko, he's like a whole other level. He's even got fashion on his side. Like, so.
Yeah, I can see that. Hopefully he got a couple girls his way, or drawing a pretty cool demon.
Well, hopefully he wasn't drawing Mara at the time.
Maybe. I imagine like him showing it to the girl, and he's like, yeah, it's that big. Like,
yeah. Yeah. I mean, aside from actually designing the characters, he does do a lot of the plot. Like the scenarios. So, like, I guess when they say scenarios, they mean that he comes up with this idea. Like, he came up with Strange Journey. He was like, "What if we do like a Tensei that's sci-fi, hardcore sci-fi themed? It's outside in the Antarctic, and we like it's just this exploration like story." And then they take that and then they make the whole story around it. He did the same thing with SMT4. I think that's like the last bit of SMT stuff he did, and outside of the art, it's just the scenarios.
Which brings us to our next subject. What has Kazuma Kaneko been doing? What do you guys think he's been doing?
I think he's been quietly either coming up with new concept art or new demons or something for the next game.
Yeah, I also kind of think that too, just because it's like 13. I mean, it's been 2013. It's been like 2 years since SMT4, and he didn't have a minor role in that, which to me makes me think if he only did the scenario, then that means that he must had like a bigger project on his plate. And then there's also the fact that his fourth art book is going to come out sometime this year, next year, or the year after, which is like a really broad span of time. But then if it comes out sooner rather than later, then it's going to be the beginning of a new IP, I think, like to drum up more interest in the franchise.
Kind of like the director of Castlevania is doing with Bloodstained.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Like, or just it might just be like instead of Devil Survivor or Devil Summoner, just it'll be a whole new spinoff. That's maybe it's Demi kids, but in the future when they're like in their mid-20s.
Demi adults.
Yeah, Demi adults.
Demi men.
I can only imagine the fandom's reaction to that. If like at the beginning of the trailer, he said based on Demi kids or something like that.
No, imagine a really, really good trailer. Like, you're just like, wow, this game, I can't wait to play it. And it's like, Demi Kid, it's 2017. Like, oh no. Do I still feel hype?
I mean, realistically speaking, if they really did do that, I think they would just, they would really call it like, oh, Shin Megami, like, they'll call it something else. And then,
yeah.
But then during the trailer, like, they'll mention, oh, it's like the spiritual successor to the Demi Kids books. But it'll be like, oh, Shin Megami Tensei, like Demon Seeds or something, you know, like something, like some name. So they're like, oh, it's not Demi Kids.
Yeah.
The last thing they want is the people think like, oh, they're fucking doing children shit.
Yeah, that's true.
So yeah, I mean that's just that seems totally out there, but it'll be pretty cool.
But
Just looking at that, like that Digimon game, the Cyber Sleuth. Like I look at that game. And I'm like, man, I could totally see an SMT game like that.
Yeah.
And I know people like to bring the parallel between that game and the Persona games, which I can see, but I still can see like the whole Digimon aspect and all that, but just, you know, with just fucking making demons, fucking make one of the kids named Mirai, and you go, there you go. Demi-C, whatever.
Well, since you brought up that game, it's funny because Yasuda, who's the artist for Digimon, that game in particular, he also did the art for the Devil Survivor series. What do you guys feel about the other two Shin Megami Tensei artists, Masayuki Dorin, Sojima, and Yasuda?
Well, me, personally, I actually like all their arts. Like, there are a lot of people that hate Sojima, but I actually kind of like his art. Like, I guess it is more generic when you compare it to some of the other art in the SMT series, but I still think it's pretty solid.
Yeah, I actually put him over, like, if I had, like, to do a top, I mean, like, a list of who's the best, it would be Kaneko, then it would be Sojima, Yasuda, and then Masayuki Dori would be the last one.
Wow.
Yeah, sorry.
I mean, yeah, that's kind of how I'd put it as well, and I like Sojima. What I really like about him is that, like I said earlier, it still looks like kind of that contemporary Japanese, but it still looks realistic. I don't like it as much as Kaneko's art style, but I still like it a lot.
Yeah, my only real complaint about Sojima is he has like a thing where he makes people have monster necks, like their necks are just unbelievable. I'm just like, oh no, poor you. His neck is like 3 feet off like a normal neck. He's like a giraffe.
At least he doesn't,
like, it's part of his persona.
At least he doesn't draw the neck like a stick.
Oh yeah. Yeah, they got some girth.
Yeah, I think I like Doi's artwork. Although I've only played from his games, I think I've only played SMT4. It's pretty cool. And just looking at the trauma center art, like it looks pretty cool. I actually like the character designs in Trauma Center more than fucking SMT4. Actually, just looking at it right here. Sojima, I mean, it's pretty standard. Like P3 and P4 look all right, I guess. I never really liked the art. I never thought the art was like too stand out, you know. Catherine,
yeah,
I think has really good art. Although I only played like an hour or two of that game, but Catherine looks pretty good. Like just like the drawings of the characters, not gameplay, you know. Yasuda though, I think it looks pretty cool. At first I really hated Devil Survivor's art. I thought the characters looked really stupid, and then I bought into the whole old girls have huge tits. But then after playing Devil Survivor, like, and you start to really feel like just from playing the game, I started to really dig the characters a lot. And then like especially like what's that guy's name, Jin? Like Jin's art.
Yeah, Jin's a cool character too.
Fuck. Yeah, I really like Jin's design.
I forget Haru's art. Even Midori, even though I don't like Midori, like her art fits for her character and like it looks really cool, I guess. Although I fucking hate her guts because of the way she acts.
But yeah, you want to like slam her into the wall or something.
Yeah, if I had to rate the artists, it's obviously Kaneko first, then Yasuda, and then probably a tie between Doi and Sojima. Not because they're the worst, but they're both equally like all right to me, like pretty cool, you know, pretty cool. If I had to give the edge, I'll say Sojima, just because like the trauma center art. I'm sorry, that's Doi. So
yeah,
Doi's better than Sojima, I guess.
And this image I just sent you is on the left, it's Kaneko's Tatsuya, and on the right is Masayuki Doi's version. His version is actually pretty cool.
There's like two different characters.
I think it's more. Yeah, it definitely gives off a completely different vibe.
Yeah, I've seen a comparison of this, but of Maya, and I like Kaneko's Maya more. People like to say that she looks like Marilyn Manson or something, but I like that. Like, that looks cool.
Well, she is one of the beautiful people, for sure.
God. But yeah, it's a pretty good picture. Like, cause it's the same character, but they both look really awesome, but in two completely different ways.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and I like how the artists aren't, like, trying to copy one another. The SMT artists, I mean.
Yeah. I think...
different interpretations of the same character. It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
But, so yeah, news involving Atlus. There isn't really much, except Atlus just announced that SMT 4 now has 600,000 sales worldwide, which is pretty good.
Fuck yeah, it's pretty awesome. Usually when a company announces how much they've sold of a game, it's always good news. Like, just, like, no one comes out and says, oh, hey, fucking, our copy, like, we only sold fucking 5,000, you know. No one ever does that. They'll say, I mean, they did it to promote the, like, their greatest hits version of on 3DS or something, right?
Yeah.
But the fact that, like, it's pretty awesome to hear that they sold so many. Because, for comparison's sake, how many copies has Persona 4 sold? Is it, like, just about a million?
Yeah, but which one, the original?
I think both. I remember reading, like, Golden has 750,000 or total. It's, I mean, for argument's sake, let's say it's, like, a million or 1.2 million. Like, if a game that had sold 1.2 million got a fucking anime and got, or two animes.
Well, it sold 0.8 million, so 800,000.
Yeah,
that's the first one.
Like, it puts to rest the whole argument that, or the whole look of the complaints that SMT's dead and we're not getting anything else. Which, I mean, I don't hear that too much, but I hear it often enough where I feel like I have to address it. Where people are like, oh, like, Persona's taking over, you know, there's gonna be no more mainline. There's no more, you know, it's all Persona now, it's all waifu shit. And, like, it's not fucking true, just because fucking the Wii U game and Persona 4 looked at, you know.
Yeah. But
you have nothing to worry about. SMT's not going to go anywhere. I'm hoping we get another game on 3DS, like, that's original. Because we only have one so far. Because the other three are... Oh, I guess Persona Q. Two. But, just, like, I mean, SMT 5, you know, fucking give me a fucking, like, chibi spin-off of Raido, and I'll be happy. I'll be fucking cool on 3DS. Demi kids.
Is that where you would want the next SMT game on the 3DS out of all consoles?
I mean, no. The only reason I said 3DS is just because they've released so many already. It's like, yeah, let's get a couple more out of the way, and then we'll move on to the PS4 or something. Just because in my head, I like to think that Atlus barely has any teams, probably three teams. I mean, I don't know. I'm not very educated in that. But, like, it's like, yeah, they've released, like, four or five fucking MegaTen on 3DS. Like, just keep them coming. Like, instead of stopping that completely and moving on to something else, just get a couple more out.
But yeah.
Obviously, if I had my way, I'd want a fucking console MegaTen. SMT5 on PS4 or PC or something. I'd buy multiple copies of that. Instantly. Two special editions, fucking everything.
I'm trying to think of the name of the team that did, okay, because I know for sure there's at least two teams. There's, the Persona team, forgot what they're called. They're called, like, P-Team or something. And then there's, yeah, and then there's the one that does the mainline. They usually go by Team Maniacs. There hasn't been anything, like, any information, like, in terms of what they're doing, Team Maniacs. Good. Which is why I'm thinking they must be working on a game, because they're always quiet when they're, like, mid-production. They don't announce
back,
until...
Go back 2 years ago, and you could replace what you just said with Team Persona, and it was the same thing. People were like,
yeah,
where's Persona 5? Like, it got fucking announced. Like, they said Catherine this, you know? It's like,
yeah,
same thing. I'm pretty confident that, like, in a year and a half or 2 years... We're going to be like, hey, are you guys looking forward to that fucking MegaTen game coming out next week? Like, you know, I'm not worried about anything at all. Especially with, I mean, just the exposure that the Persona games and MegaTen in general is getting. Like, even that Wii U game is getting all these gameplay videos, and it's getting a lot of attention. You see IGN running stories on it, like,
that's good. Yeah, it's they're coming into the mainstream media, which is... exactly what they need. They need Markiplier talking about playing one of the SMT games. That's what they desperately need right now, and they're getting it now, so that's good.
Yeah, my dream is for the the PS2 level of success, or in terms of how many games SMT got on the PS2, like, I just want them to replicate that again, which they're doing so far. Like, I think they're on the cusp of it on 3DS.
Mm-hmm.
And they have, like, four games, although three are not really, you know. But yeah, just give me more. Take any MegaTen I can get. Even, you know,
yeah, exactly.
even a fucking dancing game. Like, I got that shit pre-ordered. Can't wait to play it. But
it's really good.
Yeah,
it's really good.
Yeah, I could see you playing it on PSN. It's I'm a pretty big fan of the Project Diva games already, so I won't be surprised if that game's gonna be good. You know, obviously.
Yeah, I'm just surprised that the amount. Because, you know, when you think, okay, they're making a spinoff and it's a dancing game and they've never made a dancing game before, you would imagine the lack of a lack of polish, I would say. But in terms of it being, you know, a rhythm game, you could play through the story, you can augment the difficulty, and then you could do things to either make it, like, in terms of augmentation, you can buy things that'll make it harder, which is really fun. Like, it's very, very fun to do that. And then if you really suck at rhythm games but you just want to get the story or something, they have the option to buy things that'll make it super, super easy.
What level of the same level of that spinoff is to the Persona franchise? What can you see happening to SMT, like mainline ish? Like, what I'm trying to say is, What's the dancing all night but of SMT mainline, like Jack Bros, like a newer Jack Bros? Would that be it? A puzzle game? What do you think?
Like a dancing game or just a new? Like...
I mean, no. I mean, I doubt they could pull off a dancing game in the universe. You know, I mean, Demi-Fiend has been at a disco hall, but you know, I'm not sure if you can make a whole game out of that. I mean, they could. It'll be jumping the shark and it'll be awesome, but I don't see them actually doing that. But
yeah,
well, like, I could see them like a puzzle game. I could see that. So, you know what I mean?
I would like to see like another Jack Bros, because that game, like, even though it's difficult to play, I had to emulate it, but it plays well. It's a solid game. There's you play each of the different bros. They have different powers, and it's just it's a puzzler, and it's. And there's enough gameplay in there for replayability, and it's fun enough for replayability. And if they can handle all these different like myriad of game genres, then I basically trust them to do anything. Like, I would love a card game, as long as they didn't have a story or they didn't force a story into it or something.
I mean, it's already got a card game, hasn't it?
No, a card game.
Card game. Like a racing game.
I'd play Tensei Kart Racing.
One thing I was thinking is that maybe an FPS game. What do you guys think about that?
Whoa. The idea I always throw around is a Doom mod of Strange Journey.
That would be pretty awesome.
Any other FPS, I think, won't work. Like, you mean like a... it had to be fast-paced. I mean, yeah, Doom is the only one I can think of. I don't know what else you can really do.
I mean, that works in the sense that basically all the mainline protagonists can't use magic. They almost all use guns. So that it's kind of like that would be a nice reimagining of any game or just a spinoff. I would like a rail shooter, actually.
Well, that's kind
of
how Strange Journey worked. Like, the protagonist had a magic stat, but he didn't use magic. He used attachments for his gun.
Yeah, exactly.
And the more I think about it, I can see it working. Like, you know, look at Doom 3. It's like a horror-ish FPS that's really slow, and you're like looking at all this fucked up shit. Like, just imagine, like, even Dead Space. Replace Isaac in Dead Space with fucking Doom Guy from Strange Journey. Like, that could totally work. It's probably never gonna fucking happen, but if you want to think about a FPS or something, like, I can see that working. Like, just imagine Doom Guy coming back onto the fuck, I forgot the name of the ship. Like, coming back onto the ship, and he finds all these demons.
Red Sprite?
Yeah. Oh, I was trying to think of the blue one, because the blue one got all fucked up.
I can't remember.
Like, imagine when you're like first going on there, and then you find all these, like, the crew members are fucked up, and like some are becoming demons, or like demons are possessing them, and all this shit. I could see that working.
Yeah.
It's never going to happen, though. But like, the most we'll ever see is if someone makes a texture mod for Doom.
Well, we have enough. We have the fan base for it, so.
I mean,
someone get on it.
Somebody made a Vocaloid mod for Left 4 Dead. I don't think anybody saw that coming.
Yeah, well, I mean, Left 4 Dead has a huge community, so that, I mean, you're probably gonna get a lot of shit like that.
Doom has a pretty big fan base too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure. I'm sure there's some overlap with Doom and SMT. I have to ask around. I always ask around on the SMT General on 4chan. I remember there was a couple of people interested. They were like, "Oh yeah, that'd be totally cool." But I mean, some just don't. They say it's cool, but you know, they probably can't do it. Like me, I can't fucking do it. I don't know, fucking do that shit.
I have to learn
how to do all that.
I don't have the dedication to do that.
Yeah.
I mean, but back to Doom, on one Cathedral of Shadows episode, somebody actually asked Rosin how he'd feel about a crossover with Doom.
Oh, shit, really?
Yeah.
I never heard that episode.
It was a while back, but, I mean, somebody mentioned it, so that means the idea isn't completely irrelevant.
Yeah.
And to be honest, during Strange Journey, I was thinking this game feels a lot like an FPS.
Why? Because it's first person?
I mean, not just that. It's because the characters use guns, and you're basically a soldier that got drafted to fight for this world military or something like that. But did you guys do any of the side missions?
Yeah, I did all of them.
Yeah, there was this one where you had to, like, recover some part of this other ship. And the soldiers were saying stuff like, "Ready, aim, fire, or cover me," stuff like that. I'm just like, feels a lot like an FPS game. Of course, it's unlikely, but it's nice to think about.
What about a puzzle game?
Yeah.
How can you see a SMT puzzle game? Just like, take away story, but what kind, like, do you think, like, a Pokemon Puzzle League kind of thing?
Yes, we had that.
There's like a match three, or how about, or maybe like go a step further and make it like that Pyrojack game in Nocturne.
Yeah, that's what I was about to say.
I hated that though.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think anybody really liked that, but I mean, I liked it for the first like four levels until I was like, "What the fuck, man?" But with the channels available these days, you could totally make like a $15 download only puzzles thing with like, you know, with the fucking Jack Bros, you know, make whatever you want.
I don't know.
I think the Jack Bros, like just Jack Frost and Pyro Jack, I think them two alone are marketable enough for a mainstream audience. The people that have never heard of MegaTen or any fucking Persona could see a game with those two on there. Like, oh, hey, it's like some fucking cute puzzle game with these two guys. And then they fucking play it and like, oh shit. Now we sold like 100,000 copies of this download-only game, puzzle game, or whatever the fuck it is. Or remake Jack Bros, because Jack Bros was just a puzzle game where you had to reach Pixie, right?
Yeah, basically, you had to reach Pixie, you had to kill, like, demons here or there. Each bro had different ways of fighting, and it was basically just, like, one was stronger. I think that was Pyrojack was stronger, but he had, like, a medium-range fireball. Jack Frost used ice, he had, like, the longest range, and
Reaper used a stick.
Yeah, he just stabbed you. And it was close range, but he was the strongest, actually. No, yeah, I think he was the strongest. He's the one I used, because it was the easiest to play with, was Jack the Ripper. Or I think what they called him in the game was Jack Skeleton. So.
Jack Skeleton. Reminds you of that comic. I think his name is Red Skeleton.
But, I mean, back to that whole mainstream thing, marketing, like, a Jack Brothers game to them. Jack Brothers was the first SMT game released in North America, but, of course, it didn't sell well because it was on the Virtual Boy, and the Virtual Boy didn't sell well.
Yeah, they just had rotten luck. Like, if that game had came out on any other console, it would have done okay at best. Like, I don't see it being, like, a number one seller because it's a really simple game, but it came out on Game Boy, it would have sold all right.
I think it would have sold better than DemiKids.
Yeah, it would have actually. Like, even though
if it had come out on the App Store, might have done decent.
Yeah, like I think that's one of the cheapest, easiest like ports they could possibly do because all you would have to do is just recolor it basically to not be all red. but
dear Atlas, here is this $1 million idea.
Or 800,000.
Yeah, or here's this $10,000 idea.
All right, so would you guys like to get to emails now?
Sure. We actually got more emails than we thought in our first episode.
Yeah. All right. So SD Comics 73 says, okay, first of all, before I read this, I want to thank you, SD Comics, for being our first emailer. So,
yeah.
Kaz.
Yeah, good for you, Kaz.
So, thank you for that. And he asks, if any Megaten character were to be included as, again, by the way, this is a question about hashtag FE or Gene Ebon Roku, hashtag FE or SMTX Fire Emblem, whatever you want to call it. But he asks, if any Megaten character were to be included as a secret boss or cameo, which ones do you think would be most likely, and which ones would you personally want to see? Good luck with the podcast. Thank you. But what do you got? What about you guys? What do you think?
I'm not sure, like, who would be most likely as a cameo boss. I'm not sure. But who I would want, like, I had this cool idea of, I haven't seen much gameplay. I mean, I've seen gameplay of it, but I'm not really following that game as much as other people are. But as far as I know, is you have yourself, and then, like, when you're fighting, it's yourself, and you have a Fire Emblem character as, like, a armor thing. I'm not sure. I mean, just for me talking about it, people who are listening know what I'm talking about if they're following the game.
Yeah.
Anyways,
it's essentially just like a persona, but they just call it something else.
So my idea is like, I think a cool cameo would be the SMT1 hero as like the fight or whatever, and his persona, whatever you want to call it, is like a armored Cerberus kind of thing, because Cerberus is like his main demon. So I could totally see that like. Working with that, I mean, I choose him because the game, like in most games that have cameo battles, it's always something that's like from the, you know, obviously from the franchise. So if it's that game seems to be more like, I don't see it having Persona characters as cameo battles. So if it's gonna be SMT, it's either gonna be something from SMT 4. Or from SMT 1, because I think 1's more popular than 2. And I doubt it'd be Denny Fiend, because I don't see it working. But yeah, SMT 1 hero with Cerberus would be pretty cool cameo fight.
I mean, me personally, I personally don't think we're going to see anything that's out of the mainline SMT, but one thing I think would be nice would be the King of Bell from Devil Survivor. Because the way Devil Survivor ended, it was basically, or depending on whose route you took, and spoilers, but basically ended, for Naoya's route, it ended where you basically become this badass demon overlord, and now you're going to kill God, and then the game just cut off right there. If you could have a boss with him, that would be pretty nice, but the one I want to see that's most likely would be the Demi-Fiend, just because Nocturne ended on kind of a similar way. It's like you kill all the demons, became the Demi-Fiend, now you're working for Lucifer, and then the game ends. Spoilers.
Well, I don't really know. In terms of like the more likely, I actually think that it would be more likely for them to have a Persona 4 character, specifically Risei, just because it's like an idol type world, and you know, each person has a specific deity or whatever, and that's their persona. And then I haven't read too much into it either, but that's as far as I know. So I think, okay, well, Risei is an idol and she has a persona, so that seems likely. And then I don't want it to though.
You kill her in the game, and after you kill her, you get a secret trailer for Dancing All Night 2.
Yeah, Dancing All Night 2, more dancing. The rhythm's gonna get you.
Or Persona 3, Dancing All Night.
Persona Dancing All Night, hashtag Ebon Roku, Genkei, whatever the fuck. It's like a long ass name, like they always do.
Yeah. But then in terms of like characters I want, actually, I would rather them not have cameos at all, like that were like actual characters. I would just like maybe a signature demon, which is this case pretty much only Jack Frost. I wouldn't mind seeing like a King Frost or any of the other Frost people.
Black Frost.
Like cameo as a boss fight. Yeah, Black Frost is my favorite, so I guess I would want him the most.
Or like some of the lesser known Frosts, like from Demikids or Soul Hackers, like Frost 5.
Yeah, or Blue Hawaiian, or the Demikids Diana. Yeah, but aside from that, I don't really have anybody in mind. I kind of don't want them to do that cameo, though, because I want it to be so oriented around building this world without being too Fire Emblem-y or too Megami Tensei-y.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm with you on that.
All right, next email. Edward says, "Hey guys, I'm Edward. Great podcast. Thank you for doing this. It definitely eases the pain of Cathedral of Shadows being gone. Anyway, my question is, how do you guys feel about the amount of DLC in SMT4 and how that might affect upcoming games?"
More of it. Expect more DLC.
Yeah, I think we'll expect more DLC.
Just look at SMT4, Persona 4 Arena, Persona 4 Arena Ultimax, and Persona Q. Look at all the DLC, and that should just tell you right there.
Yeah, my only expectation or desire for the DLC is to not make it the way SMT4 is, in the sense that some of the scenarios brings closure to the story, at least in my opinion.
I mean, we were talking about that before. The big DLC that I think should not. Okay, you meet the four archangels. Oh, spoilers! Although I just kind of spoiled it, but whatever. I mean, that's pretty obvious. Yeah. SMT4. So you meet the four archangels in the game. You never really fight them, but in the DLC you kind of fight them, but you go back in time. Like, that just feels like I'm totally gypped.
Yeah.
So it's like that DLC. I mean, it's just weird. It feels like the fight was made for the DLC only, but it's like, man, that it still isn't really closure. Those fights and Masakado probably should not have been in DLC.
I mean,
exactly.
You see the four archangels, you see their designs in the game, and then you're like, oh, you have to fight them, you gotta purchase our DLC.
Yeah, I just don't want them to do that. I like the other DLC options, which are just, you know, aesthetic, more or less, or making the game easier, I guess.
Yeah,
but like
those microtransaction DLCs I never really cared about. And
yeah.
I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but doesn't Record Breaker have something like you could buy, or am I wrong?
It has this, grinding thing that you can buy. I mean, SMT4 had this too, but Devil Survivor also has it.
Yeah, I never cared for that.
Devil I pre-ordered Devil Survivor and got it on day one, but it also had this thing where it would download these unlockable demons to your 3DS, and then it would say, all these demons have been unlocked. And I don't know how that works for people that got the game later, but... Still.
Like, I mean, for the most part, like, expect a lot of DLC, but besides a couple things with SMT4, like, Persona 4 Arena, most of the DLC I don't really care about. It's, like, alternate colors, alternate, voiceovers for your narrator.
Yeah.
Because I bought Persona 4 Arena, like, Ultimate Edition, and it came with all the DLC. And when I went to download DLC, like, the only one I downloaded was, like, alternate colors, and even that one I didn't even use because the colors were retarded. So it's expect DLC, but don't expect anything crazy. Do you guys know about Persona Q DLC? Like, is it bad? Is it, you know, what is it?
I don't know anything about it.
Persona Q DLC, yeah, this is the only game I haven't beaten in English because it's... I'm not going to say it. Yeah, there's...
It's too good, it's, right?
Yeah, it's so great that I got to leave it for last. It's got to be the last SMT game I ever play. But it's pretty irrelevant stuff.
Probably just
one
like
one thing that bothers me.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm?
It's probably
skipping. Sorry. Okay, you go.
Sorry, it's probably just like skipping stuff. Like, I guess just like those kind of transactions or more people you could navigate to voice or something.
Yeah, it's those dumb ones. Yeah, the navigation things really pointless. I think, like, I haven't seen the game in a while, but I think there, like, it does have things where you unlock the other demons or other persona via microtransaction, which is lame, especially if you're a completionist who wants to get all your compendium complete. That is really lame, and you should not do that. But if they do what they did with, like, Persona Arena, where the any, like, actually important DLC is free for a while, I think that's an okay, like happy medium.
Oh, right. Didn't Ultimax have Adachi and someone else for free?
Yeah, Adachi and Marie, yeah. But then, so then I just looked up the DLC for Persona Q. Yeah, you would have to buy Orpheus, Telos, I'm just going to butcher these names, Megatsu, Izanagi, and Thanatos. You have to buy those, and I hate that, because that detracts from the game for me. Like, that's not a good DLC.
I mean, yeah, well, if that isn't in there, and SMT4 has Ultimate Fights in there, then you could kind of expect Persona Live to have something like that.
Yeah, luckily, at least Devil Survivor doesn't really have that. It doesn't have anything besides things that if you suck, then it makes it easier for you.
Yeah, but sorry. Keep in mind that those games came out before they kind of started their DLC thing.
Yeah.
At least the original games. So, like, when they made the remakes, they probably couldn't think of anything to sell.
Yeah.
Like, with most games with DLC, I don't really care for DLC. Like, I don't really mind. I never really have a problem with it. Because usually it's like, if I like a game so much and I want more of it, it's like, $2, whatever. $5, whatever.
Yeah.
Like, especially like Battlefield. Like, if I play a lot of it, I'm like, damn, like, I want to play more of it. And they made new maps. I should buy the new maps. You know, because they're pretty awesome. And I'm the same way with other games. He's like, yeah, I spent $60 in the game. Should I spend 10 more to get something, something? I'm like, yeah, well, I enjoy the game. Might as well. As long as I know what it is, you know.
Yeah. And as long as it's not, like I keep trying to say, is basically if it's not a chunk of the game that's just missing, and then you buy that DLC to get that chunk back, that's the DLC that bothers me.
Yeah,
that's
pretty bad. Like, yeah.
And it doesn't look like... Sorry, go ahead.
Do you guys have any, like, games that have done that besides SMT4? Do you, like, know of any?
I don't really foray into DLC too much. And even in SMT4's DLC, it does remove some of the gameplay, but you can really get the gist of the story without it. It's just like, you know, kind of what Sin was saying about wanting more of the game, more or less.
Yeah.
Like, I guess.
I can't really think of much. The one example I could think of, although I never play the game, one of my best friends plays a lot of Assassin's Creed, and I think, like, Assassin's Creed 2 or one of them, like, the game is divided into, like, I don't know, 12 or 15 chapters, and in the story, like, while you're playing the game, like, chapter 8 is missing, and you have to buy it if you want to play chapter 8. You know what I mean? So that's clearly not part of the game, you know, and he actually bought it and played it, and he says that, like, yeah, you don't need to play it. But the fact that, like, the game is telling you that you have, you know, you have to do these 15 parts, but two are missing, you have to buy them. I mean, I don't know. If you're going to do that, then make it like, oh, missions 1 through 10, and here's the special mission 1, special mission 2. But to have it, like, stick right out of there, you know?
Yeah.
Like, imagine, I think Dragon Age Origins did the same thing, where when you get to camp, and in camp, there's a guy you could talk to. And when you talk to him, he's like, hey, there's something going on over here. Do you want to go? And one of the options, like, the option to pitch for yes is to go buy the DLC. So it's like, man, imagine you're playing Persona 5, and you're like, oh my god, fucking, our little cat got captured. We need to go rescue him. And then somebody's like, oh, we don't need him for this mission, though. Like, yeah, but we should rescue him. What do you think, protagonist? And then what if there's a fucking link to the PSN to buy that DLC to see the cat?
That would piss a lot of people off.
Yeah, that's the kind of shit, yeah. And as far as I know, that rarely happens.
I mean, I don't think that's going to happen.
I mean, I just
thought of a time that's happened. I don't know if you guys ever played Asura's Wrath, have you?
Oh, yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
The, like, spoilers, but the main ending, right?
Yeah, the real ending that you need. yeah, that happened there, and actually it made me not play the game anymore. I didn't buy the DLC. Just like, yeah, like, no, you guys ruined the game for me.
Yeah, I heard about that. That's really bad.
I like that game too.
I mean, people complain about Call of Duty's DLC because they release like 4 every year, but it's not like you're buying a portion of the game. It's just, you like this game.
It's to keep you going, yeah.
Yeah, those map packs are for people that love the game and they're gonna play it like 500 hours that year. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like if you play the game and you play like a couple hours a day, I mean a couple hours a week, you know, then that DLC isn't for you. You don't need to buy it.
Yeah. So I wouldn't mind getting that kind of DLC. Is pretty much all I have to say about DLC now.
So if Persona 5 had DLC, what, like, think of a good idea. Like, what kind of DLC do you want to see? Like, let's say when you beat the game, there's obviously like going to be there isn't an end game in Persona, but just imagine like you spend $10 and you get this super hard fucking extra dungeon that they release like 6 months after the game comes out or something, like that's not too bad.
Something to dust off your console. I mean your cartridge and play it again. I wouldn't mind that.
My Persona 5 cartridge.
Especially if it was a... Hmm? Oh, sorry. Yeah, I don't know why I said cartridge.
No, but yeah, like, that would be something cool. But if the game comes out and is already like, oh, that super hard dungeon is already out for $10, I probably won't buy it until that DLC goes on sale or like fucking... Or like if I want to play the game again like 10 years or something like that.
Yeah.
Like The Answer. The Answer, I could see them being a DLC.
Yeah, that's what I was about to say. Like, instead of releasing an entirely different game, they could just make that DLC.
Persona 5, The Response.
They should have just made that a video, because... Oh, once I was done playing it, I'm like, I wish I just watched this on YouTube.
Yeah, I remember playing The Answer, and people told me on the MegaTen subreddit, they said, yeah, just watch the cutscenes on YouTube. I was like, I heard it's only 30 hours long. Like, I have 30 hours to kill. You know, let me play it. And I played it for, like, I think 10 hours. And I was like, man, mm-hmm. These fights are... you have to grind a lot. Or I probably just suck, but a lot of people have told me that. Like, yeah, you have to grind a shitload.
No, you don't suck. It's you have to grind a lot.
And then there's no compendium. And it's just... Man, it just wasn't fun. And yeah. even after playing 60 hours of Tartarus, I didn't really hate Tartarus, but just from playing like a few hours of whatever the fuck it was in The Answer, I was like, yeah, I'll just open up YouTube and watch it, and I did, and it was cool to watch.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't really know if this would be like part of the story or not, but if they did what Fallout 3 did, where after the game is over, you get to play some more, like spoilers for Fallout 3, what happens at the end is the protagonist goes into this irradiated tube thing to punch in some kind of code, and then he ends up dying, but if you purchase a Broken Steel DLC, he just wakes up from a coma.
I mean, that's a fucked up retcon. I'd be pissed if there was... I'd be pissed, like, let's say, in The Answer... obviously spoilers for Persona 3. I'd be pissed if like 5 minutes into The Answer, you know, you just wake up from the seal. Like, that would piss me off.
I always thought that's funny because amongst my friends, when we say you broke the seal, it's like, oh, like you drank too much and now you have to use the bathroom. So if you say P3 guy broke the seal, you got a whiz.
I was like, using that break the seal, break the great seal.
I mean, I don't really know how I'd feel if they did that. I mean, I feel it was kind of necessary for Fallout 3 because I wasn't really satisfied with that game's ending. But
yeah, that one was, I mean, it was probably made because people complained. Right.
Yeah, but
look at Mass Effect 3 DLC. Like, they made a DLC because people hated the ending.
Bringing back P3 guy would be the same as reviving Nanako for no reason because of magic or whatever reason she came back to life.
Spoilers.
Oh, spoilers for P4.
fuck it.
Sorry.
I think we're gonna have an episode just for about how much we dislike Nanako.
We would have to. It'd have to be like a 12 episode series.
Yeah. Nanako and Teddy. 2016, the season of anti Nanako.
I don't really have that much of a problem with Nanako, but if there are Persona characters that I just don't like, it's Koromaru.
He was supposed to be a Dalmatian originally. Like, would you like him better if he's a Dalmatian?
It's not so much his breed, it's just he felt like a useless character. It's like, yeah, we're going into Tartarus fighting these demons. Shadows, trying to figure out what's causing them, and now we have this dog. And it's like,
yeah, but he didn't have much of a follow-up. That was the big thing.
Well, I mean, he had a rough life. You know, he was barking up the wrong tree.
Literally.
His whole life.
But, I mean, it's just, here's this dog, and that's it.
Yeah, when you first meet him, and you first, like, up until when he joined your party, like, just everything about him, I thought was really cool. And I was like, oh shit, I guess the dorm is gonna get a dog. I didn't think I was getting a fucking party member. That's the part where I'm like, I don't know.
I think that what happened is they got so excited about the idea that once they did it, it like just fell flat. And even like, it's crazy because when I think of all the social links in P3, I think his was probably the weakest. And that's just weird for a main character to have such a weak story and such weak involvement. Like, there really isn't any reason for him, but except the fact that they have a dog. It could have been anything. It could have been a shoe, like...
Exactly.
Yeah.
Anyway, last email, or sorry, not the last, but these last two are from the same person. Chaos says, SMT games are pretty much notorious for being difficult. I'm sure Nocturne and Digital Devil Saga put a lot of gamers off from playing SMT games altogether, especially casual gamers that picked up one of these games without knowing what they were getting into. Do you think the difficulty of the SMT games is what keeps them locked in the niche market they're in?
No.
No.
No. What keeps SMT in the niche is just that JRPGs in general are in a niche.
That's what I was going to say. And I mean, they're not as popular as they were during the PlayStation days.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. Like, I think Legend of Dragoon probably sold more than every SMT game in existence.
Like, yeah.
And that game wasn't even that huge, but yeah.
That was when we were still, like, recovering from the video game crash of 1983, so that was kind of when pretty much all games were still being made in Japan. So that's a lot of what we had, but now we have other games. We have games like just big AAA games from Western developers, and people just don't really pay much attention to JRPGs anymore.
I think what really turned JRPGs niche is just the move onto the PS2, and then between the PS2 and PS3 era is just where, like, how many JRPGs were on PS2? Fucking ton. How many are on PS3? Yeah. Like, a lot, but not as many as PS2, and not as many of quality. And you can totally fucking insult me all you want for saying that, but there aren't that many amazing RPGs on the PS3 era.
I mean,
era.
Yeah, like, there isn't.
Like, there's a bunch. Like, Tales of Vesperia is amazing, and people say Xenoblade, but I could name a shitload of those those caliber games on the PS2. So from there, it went niche, because suddenly there weren't that many Final Fantasy coming. I mean, there were three Final Fantasy games.
I'd say only JRPG franchises that are actually, like, mainstream, at least over here in North America, are Pokemon and Final Fantasy.
Yeah. Yeah. People argue that Pokemon isn't JRPG, but at the end of the day, it is.
Yeah.
I mean, so far we've gotten, like, we're getting a lot of JRPGs, just now they're coming on handhelds primarily. Right. Which, I don't mind. I like playing on the handheld. I just would like variety, you know? In terms of what to play it on. And we're getting a bunch on PC, too, which is awesome. I mean, I don't really play on my PC too much, but a lot of people do, and it's good that they're finally getting Tales games, and they're finally getting, like, Hyper Dimension Neptunia games, and the Legend of Heroes games, like, that's cool. And we're getting a lot of those on Vita and 3DS. But I'd like them. It would be cool if JRPGs got back on home consoles, and hopefully Dragon Quest XI and Final Fantasy XV, and I mean, because Xenoblade, I don't think it's gonna sell too well. Not because it's on Wii U, but the first Xenoblade didn't sell amazing. But yeah, I'm hoping that like Tales of Zestiria and, you know, Final Fantasy XV, like the real heavy hitters on consoles, I'm hoping they sell really well so that people are like, yeah, these are pretty cool games. And then companies start bringing more over.
Yeah. So,
I mean,
and then just my whole take on the whole difficulty and why SMT is niche is just I think it's the time it came out. Yeah, PS2 actually had a lot of good RPGs, but I think the real era where RPGs thrived the most was the PS1 era. Because I'm looking at the sales, like Legend of Dragoon sold almost 2 million, Nocturne sold almost 400,000. You have other games like Dragon Quest VII sold almost 5 million. And it's just that time period, that was when you could basically release any RPG, and it was probably going to get played, and then it was going to get drummed up in any media outlet. It was going to be talked about in any review magazine. So the fact that it came, we started with Nocturne, which is different from most JRPGs. We didn't start with SMT 1 or 2, which still different, but probably would have played off better if it was released over here at the same time as Legend of Dragoon. Like, all that, it just adds up to it just being the wrong time or the wrong console. Just like 9 is not a bad SMT game, just came out on the wrong console.
And it was only in Japan.
So, yeah, and it was only in Japan. If it came out in America, I wouldn't be surprised if 9 did like pretty good and actually was able to fund the MMO aspect just due to the sales, because it wasn't a bad game. And that's just the story of Shin Megami Tensei. Wrong place, wrong time and for Western audiences.
Yeah, and back to what you were saying. Yeah,
so
yeah, go ahead.
No. So I just hope that in the future, like, it's right now we're hitting the right place. Sure, Persona isn't the SMT that we want, not a lot of the fans want right now, but it's the one that we need, because it's capturing the JRPG market a lot more than any other SMT can right now, I think.
Yeah,
right. And back to what I was saying earlier about, like, now we have other games. A lot of games today, like Skyrim or Fallout, they're all being marketed as just RPGs, just like JRPGs were back in the PlayStation days. And I think that they're just being swept under the rug because of those games.
Yeah, that too.
Those games are just huge.
Right.
Especially with the current gamer mindset is really dedicated to graphics and gameplay. If the gameplay isn't some sort of new innovation or intuitive in a aspect that Western audiences are used to, like Demon's Souls or Dragon Age or some other Western style game, it doesn't receive the same like mention as if. Like, I'm kind of afraid of the new Dragon Quest, because I don't know if it's going to even sell as well because it doesn't have the Western sensibility.
Is that one going to be turn-based?
I don't even know, but like I haven't played the last...
It seems like every huge RPG, even like the Japanese ones coming on console, like none are turn-based. Final Fantasy XV isn't going to be turn-based.
Yeah.
I mean, if you count Dark Souls, those aren't turn-based.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like the big ones, the ones that are selling, the ones people like talk about, they're not turn based. The biggest turn based one is, you know, fucking Pokemon.
Yeah.
And then, you know, Persona, and then whatever else we have, Hyper Dimension Neptunia and all that.
Yeah, and back to what Keith was saying earlier, like JRPGs today, at least, just don't have good graphics compared to other games. Like, that's not really a problem for me, but if I was just your average gamer and then I saw a game like Disgaea, I'd probably just look at the graphics and be like, wow, this game's gonna suck.
I mean, and for Disgaea, the art style.
Yeah, that's true.
Because Persona 5 has a... I think Persona 5 is gonna sell better than... Well, has a potential to sell better than 4, because the art style isn't so... I guess I'm gonna say anime. Like, it's kind of like in the middle, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Although it looks more like Persona 3, but that one, I could see, if they market it well, it could sell a lot, but it's still going to be turn-based. But,
yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that, but I'm just kind of saying that it's an odd correlation that turn-based games are not really selling as much. Fire Emblem, I guess, sells well.
If you count that, yeah, that's true. More like tactical.
Yeah. Yeah. But, yeah, to answer the original email's question of, is the difficulty what keeps him locked in the niche? No. I think if Nocturne was super fucking easy, it would have sold the same.
Yeah, it's just the fact that it's a JRPG in this age. And
like, most of the time with difficulty, like, it seems like if you like a game, you're going to keep playing it, even if it's hard, and you're going to beat it.
I mean, take a look at Dark Souls. Those games are Dark Souls, Demon Souls. Those games are notorious for their difficulty, and they're very popular.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think they broke the niche a little.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thankfully, where it's people want hard games. So if you show them, hey, like, let's say they come out with a new one and say, hey, you should play this game. It's fucking super hard. You know, beat the demons or, like, you know, overcome your whatever. Prepare to die. So obviously, they can't use prepare to die, but, you know.
But, yeah. All right, thank you for your question, Chaos. And
he has another question.
So his next question is: anyone have a favorite boss in any SMT game? It can be more than one boss. For me, it's Matador from Nocturne. Fighting him actually teaches you how to play the game. You quickly learn that buffing skills are not to be underestimated, and you get a good idea of how you need to exploit your opponent's weaknesses at every opportunity you get. So
that's Matador for anyone else. Man, it's weird that he said that, because my favorite boss fight is Matador in Nocturne, but for different reasons. Not so much because he teaches you how to play, but more because the presentation. Like, you know, you're just going through the sewers, you're talking to these fucking mannequins, and you're just going through this fucking door. Next thing you know, like, the game's getting all blurry, the screen's telling you, like, you know, like, there's a demon presence, say, should you continue? And next thing you know, like, you get pulled into this fucking other world, this fucking crazy storm going on, you got this just the atmosphere is ridiculous, man. That fight gives me chills just fucking thinking about it. The music comes on, and this motherfucker's challenging you to a duel. Just everything about it just pumps me up. And then the fight starts. The fight starts, and the lighting is different, where it's darker. So, like, Matador's face and, like, your demons, you guys, they all have shadows on their faces, when you're not used to seeing at that point. I don't know, like, that fight's pretty fucking it's pretty amazing. Because the first few hours of Nocturne are pretty straightforward, like, hey, go here, okay, now go here. Nothing really crazy happens, besides the conception, obviously. But, like, there's nothing really crazy, so that's the first, like, boom, fucking demon world here.
And you don't get to save before it.
Yeah, no, I mean, there's a save point, but it's a ways away before that. So, and then obviously after that, the fight's the first difficult fight of the game, where you have to learn, you have to use whatever. Actually, it took me 3 tries to beat him, just because I was being stupid. I got too cocky.
Yeah.
But yeah, that I say that's my favorite fight.
My favorite fight is, it's Babel from the original Devil Survivor. It's because the music is awesome. Second of all, it's because you're basically fighting a demonized version of the Tower of Babel. It's like just this big, huge tower that's covered in eyeballs, and he's the demon server and stuff. It's like, I never expected to fight that thing as a boss, and if fighting the Tower of Babel isn't cool, I don't know what is.
Yeah, that's pretty out there.
I mean, the only...
So then...
Go ahead.
No, that's not, like, So then it was, like, a difficulty that got you, like, it was the atmosphere and difficulty together?
Yeah, it was. And on the route that I took, I actually lost my demons. I'm like, I didn't expect that, but I still managed to beat him on my first try. And it was also the first SMT final boss that I faced, so it's kind of special.
Yeah, that's a pretty special feeling. Just being your first SMTs is pretty good feeling.
I had started Persona 3 before that, but That game is ridiculously long, so I actually ended up beating Devil Survivor before.
Yeah. So I was trying to think of my favorite boss fight for like the majority of this this podcast, and
yeah, it's gotta be hard for you because you played all the fucking games.
Yeah, it's not only that, but it's like there's like all these different things come into play. So then when it comes to the actual fight itself, and you know, like what you guys are talking about with atmosphere and difficulty, then I'm gonna just go with the fight against Demi-Fiend. It's funny.
DDS?
DDS. I don't, like, people say it's super hard. It's just, I would say it's more laborious than hard. Like, you just have to, you're basically doing the same thing over and over, but it's just everything about the fight leading, like, you're playing him, like, it's basically like you're a random encounter to him, because it's the normal battle music from Nocturne, so it's like, to him, from his perspective, it's nothing special. You're just some people that he ran into. And given Nocturne's like difficulty, it's like, oh, maybe you could probably wipe from this random encounter. So to me, it's like you're nothing to him, but to him, I mean, but from your perspective, he's like some super ultimately strong guy, and you like barely win, I would say. And it's just so that like whole juxtaposition is really funny to me. So that's probably my favorite in terms of just like atmosphere and stuff. But then my other favorite one is Teddy's shadow in Persona 4, because I really, really like, if there's characters that I just don't like, it's Teddy and Nanako. Sure. And I thoroughly enjoyed killing Teddy's shadow. I just wish that Teddy died when his shadow died. But
I mean, it would make sense, because spoilers, Teddy technically is a shadow.
Yeah. And like, there's also this fan theory that Teddy is Yu's shadow, because Teddy only comes into existence when they first go into that world. And like, if you remember in the first, like your first experience is you put your hand randomly into the TV, and the theory goes that when you did that, that was the birth of Teddy. And all like everything leading up to that point, like it's like until he defeats his own shadow, is him being a reflection more or less of Yu. And then once you defeat the shadow, that's when Teddy like comes into his own and becomes his own character, and that's why he becomes really lame, more lame than he already was later on.
Yeah,
I think Teddy is terrible too.
Yeah,
I think we should have a whole episode about how we hate him as well as Nanako, because I can go about that.
Yeah, Nanako, Teddy, and then a short like a half like segment about Koromaru.
Oh man.
And Koromaru's persona being dog.
It's funny because I actually really love Persona 3 and 4.
Yeah.
So, but it's like some parts of it I just fucking hate.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's like bound to happen for any game that's that long.
I mean, yeah, but like, let's talk about Strange Journey. Like, do I hate anything for Strange Journey? Fuck no. I can't think of anything I really dislike about Strange Journey besides maybe
Ashura.
That's a different thing, but just like the sources things with like fusing demons and skills. That's probably the only thing I don't like.
I like the sources.
I mean, that's more because SMT4 spoiled me, and even Nocturne, and you know what I mean. That's not a big deal. Like Strange Journey, I have no problems with Nocturne. The only problem with Nocturne is that it doesn't have that many demons. But besides that, I like no problems with it. But Persona 3, I got a few problems with that.
I mean, the thing is, Strange Journey is like, what, 35 to 40 hours. Persona 3 took me like 95 hours to beat my first time.
Strange Journey took me, I think, 49 hours my first time. Persona 4 took me 53.
Seriously?
Mm-hmm. I have a screenshot to prove it on my Vita.
My Strange Journey took like 50 hours?
Yeah.
I don't know if I was just doing Strange Journey wrong, but it just took me a long time.
I mean, well, I towards the end, I started grinding because I wanted Shiva really bad. And so that was, like, a lot of grinding. Funny story, all that grinding was done listening to Cathedral of Shadows. That's when I was really into them.
Oh, snap.
Yeah. Good homage to those guys. Or good mention of those guys.
I don't know. I think mostly it was just Iridanus or whatever. That zone or sector had me just going in circles for a really long time.
I loved it. I loved every minute I was in that fucking zone.
Wait a minute, is that the one where you, spoiler alert, fight Maya?
No.
Okay, I'm...
That's Ouroboros. Oh, okay.
Yeah, Maya, I think, is... it's
whatever F is.
It's F or G. I think it is F.
I absolutely hated that dungeon. I didn't mind Sector Erdanus because... Well, first of all, I liked it how you... did any of you guys do the Yggdrasil quest at the second place?
I
did it later
started
on.
Started it, but I never finished it.
Yeah, well, when you go to Sector E, that's where you fight him for real. And I think it's cool just going back to a place that you visited earlier at the beginning of the game.
Yeah. Even though I spent a lot of time in Sector E, I enjoyed it. Like, I liked being lost because the way I played, the old games. I played SMT1 and 2, then I played Strange Journey. And I was like, oh, this feels so good. It's like a perfect balance of SMT1 and 2 and, like, Nocturne or something, because, like, I didn't play SMT4 yet.
Yeah,
so I don't think it was out yet.
Going back to what I keep saying, the word I use a lot, atmosphere. That's why that's why I liked Sector E, because the way the map looked, like the dungeon looked, and the music, like it was fun, it was cool. And by that part of the game, like my demons were fucking lethal as fuck, so I couldn't really die. So like the only times I would die is like if my main character got that bomb status and then got attacked immediately. It's like, oh, well, fucking great. But that didn't really happen.
Yeah, I just wanted to like augment that last question and say ask what was your least favorite boss.
Ooh, in terms of like, difficult or just
anything? Because anything, because like for me, I could tell you right now, like Matador was actually my least favorite boss, because Nocturne was the first SMT game I ever played. It was the first like hard game I ever played, so I didn't understand like why it was so hard. I didn't understand like how SMT worked. So I was just kind of barely like sliding through, barely beating Fornius, but like doing anything. Then when it said, "Oh, a strong demon," I was like, "Yeah, it's not gonna be that strong." And then I just kept wiping over and over and over. And I would grind, and then I would forget to save, and I'd be like, "Cool, well now I'm gonna game over, and I'm gonna have to do it all over." So I really like he actually put me off the game for almost a month before I came back to it.
Shit.
And I was like really weak. I was like really not good at SMT.
I mean, for me, my least favorite boss is Ashura from Strange Journey. It's not because he's hard, which he is, but I actually like bosses where they force me to like just be a tryhard, kind of like Beelzebub from Nocturne, where I had to have null death on all my party members. I like bosses like that, but Ashura, it was basically just luck, because that attack he did where it would charm your entire party. There's really no strategy except to just keep attacking him and hope that your entire party doesn't get charmed. If your entire party gets charmed, you might as well just reset the
game. I had Amrita by then.
I think so.
Because I remember that not being the problem. The problem I had in that fight was just one of his moves was like way really strong.
I mean, even if you have Amrita, if your Amrita user gets charmed, which she probably will, there's nothing you can do.
Yeah. Fuck, I think my least favorite fight, off the top of my head, is probably Belbereth or fucking Tower of Babel, which is funny that's your favorite one. Just because I thought the tower looked stupid, how the graphics suddenly become all 3D, and just like overall that fight just came out of nowhere. And on top of that, like the map, because I beat the game twice, Atsuro route and Yuzu, and on the Atsuro route, like the final level is just full of so many annoying demons. By the time you get to the final boss, you're just like, get this shit over with, man. And so that's probably why I probably just associate all that hate with him. I mean, other than that, like, the only real bosses I dislike are the ones that are really, like, lame or, like, filler bosses, I guess I want to say. Like, in Nocturne, like, when you're leaving the prison, you fight, like, a full blue snake. Like, it gets me annoyed. Or, like all the boss is a shitload of slimes, or, you know, like, remember that? Like, I think that happens a couple times. Like, the boss music comes on, and, oh, it's seven phantasms. Oh, my God. Just really lazy bosses. Most of the Persona 3 Tartarus bosses are that. I think all of them. Because the only real bosses are the ones you fight in the full moons. Strange Journey. I mean, Strange Journey had pretty cool bosses. I liked them all. The only real annoying one was Asura, but not really. I mean, yeah, it was annoying, as in, like, with my most retries. I mean, the final boss was super fucking difficult, but I fucking love that fight. That's all final boss should be. Make you feel
it's
like
rewarding. It's
make
rewarding.
Make you feel like you really did just fucking save the earth.
Yeah.
I mean, most MegaTen, I guess, are like that. Like, by the time you get to the end, you're just like, man, like, I had to buff myself so much just to even scratch this bitch. Like, yeah, well, that's because you're trying to beat someone, trying to fucking destroy the whole earth, you know? Or, like, oh, you're fighting a god. That's what happens when you fight a god. You can't just easily punch a god in the face. You gotta fucking work for it, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, well, back to filler bosses. I hate it when you have to fight a boss and it's basically just a generic enemy that you can encounter all over the place. It's like Strange Journey in the beginning. When you fight him at the beginning of Strange Journey, you level up about 30 or so levels, and then you see him and be like, wait, I fought this thing before. Like, if you're going to include a generic demon as a boss, you should at least make it like a demon that you don't encounter very easily, like a light demon. But that's not what they did. And, like, in SMT4, there were a few bosses where I would just, like, it's like you gotta fight this boss, and it's basically the exact same demon that you've been killing a bunch of on the way up here, and this one just has a whole bunch of health.
Yeah, some of the side quests were like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, but there's not that many bosses I dislike. Some are just too easy. Like, final bosses that are too easy get on my nerves. SMT4 is that culprit. Like, I just wish that fight had a lot more. Because I never fought the neutral route, but the Law and Chaos final bosses, I just wish that both final bosses had a lot more health, just to, like, draw it out longer at least. Because it was, like, four turns, I think, at most, both fights. Like, total, you know, like, with press turns and all that.
Yeah.
It's fucking bullshit.
Well, I mean, I wish their attacks were more powerful. For me, it was just spam Luster Candy and debilitate until it's maxed out.
Yeah, it's like, fuck, man. Like, I could think of ways, just give the boss Dekaja and then Dekunda, and then have them have, like, more press turns and some shit.
Well, I mean, they do have Silent Prayer and those two moves you mentioned, but they just don't use them. The AI isn't very smart.
Yeah. And if you don't like easy boss battles, you're going to really not like another Bible, even though it's like super quick. Like, you could beat that game with your characters being level like 30, and the boss has like 3 transformations, and you could beat them all like really, really quickly, especially because you're allowed to have like 12 characters out on the field all at once.
Like, one of the things I like about Strange Journey is just like every boss just feels satisfying when you beat it.
Yeah.
Because some are pretty easy. Like the first, second, and third sector bosses are pretty easy, you know. By then you should know what you're doing. Fourth sector gets a little difficult, but just from there, just like the way they're presented and like the way you have to beat them isn't just straight just attacking. You kind of work with it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and also the way the dungeon is really big. It's like you've worked your way through this dungeon, and now you have to fight this thing. It's like the whole dungeon has been building up to this moment.
And sometimes the demon fucks with you while you're on the way up there. Like, exactly. Asura, you know? It's pretty cool. Is his name Horcus?
Yeah.
Sector 3? Like, he's a fucking asshole to you and shit. He's just to everyone. But he's still easy.
And then in another dungeon you get to fight them again, except they're in different forms.
Yeah, and you beat them all.
It's like, yeah, you thought you killed me, now you gotta kill me again.
Except now I'm a fucking female. In the case of a...
Yeah. But anyway, that's it for this episode. Be remember, guys, be sure to email your questions or whatever you want heard on the podcast to hereticmansion@gmail.com, and thank you for listening.
We'll see you guys next week.
Right. See you next week.
Take it easy. Later.
Play MegaTen.
Now. Yep.